step. You will remain a marginal, rejected by majority, and so on. Let me make it very clear. If this were to become a state politics, let's just open borders. You would have in 1 month not the imperialist revolution, but the frustrated working class revolution. Beware what happened in the United States. Do you remember that? There are also moments of beautiful solidarity. I remember how, I think, in Seattle, something beautiful happened. Immigrants, Spaniards, and your own trade unions demonstrated together. This was a beautiful moment. But as a counter example, don't forget that it was Bush, not the Democratic president, who tried to, who did the first legalization, you know, that rule, if you are 2 years here, you get the green card or whatever. Because to put it in the most primitive terms of class analysis, it is in the interest of the ruling class to liberalize immigration, or to put it in a different way. You know, some leftists usually talk as if anti-immigrant racism is some kind of a imperialist plot out there. No, it's a spontaneous lower class reaction. And this is what is prohibited to say. I said this at a Marxist conference in London, and it didn't go too well. No? They desperately tried to evoke some examples and so on of how, no, but once in East End, workers were also demonstrating for the Pakistani and so on, while, as you probably know, the most exploding in the number of votes party in Britain today is the BNP, British National Party, no? Which is strictly a working class party, no? And immigrant and so on and so on. So what I'm saying is that the situation described by Zaire Apollo, there is a moment of truth in it, my God. Capitalism has this, has reinvented itself after 68 with this really terrifying, efficient, let's call it bombastically postmodern, whatever, dynamics. And sorry to tell you, I don't see any serious, what they call it, immediate, at least, alternative of the left. I respect them. The left is the moderate left, all the economic Stiglitz, Krugman. They did make one point, and of course here is where our attack should admit, so that now you will see that I'm not a total liberal idiot or whatever. I am opposed to this. You know where the description is obviously false? When Zaire Apollo describes, opposes in such a stupid way, bureaucracy and market. Wait a minute. Today's postmodern capitalism, precisely in its flexibility and dynamics, needs more than ever state mediation and state regulation. I mean, are we aware that, look at all the world celebrated now United States as the model of how to avoid Europe's mistake, clinging to old welfare models, blah, blah, postmodern dynamic capitalism. Yes, but the state, sorry to tell you what you know better than me, the state exploded the strength of the United, and not only anti-terrorist, even regulatory and all others. So this is the first way to, the first way to complicate things. But nevertheless, it's so sad I don't have time to go more into it, because the only original idea of the left, which as far as I know, I may be wrong, apart from returning to Keynes, and at least Krugman is honest enough, no? He said basically, explicitly, in a couple of texts that I read, let's return to Keynes. In short term, I tend to agree. I just wonder if it works in the long term. Correct me if I'm wrong, but the only global, not some specificity or some, I don't know what country, global model that was seriously presented, and it's interesting, but I don't think it works. I'm sorry, I don't have time now to develop, would have been, I don't know how popular it is here. In Europe and in Latin America, it's now extremely popular, the so-called basic income model. No, it is already, it was invented by Robert Van Parijs, I hope I pronounce it correctly, a Belgian leftist sociologist economist. It is totally supported by the Negri gang, Negri Heart and so on. And it has many advocates already in the European Union, in South Africa and in Latin American countries. For example, it was already legalized, passed into a law in Brazil. Okay, they said we will now gradually realize it. humankind. But the idea is an elementary one. The idea is that our societies are rich enough to provide for every member of society, irrespective of you work or not, a basic income. You get it as a citizen. A basic income presenting you to live a modest but still human life. And the argumentation is very nice. Up to the point even Marxist, the argumentation is that, hey, it is feasible because the majority of the people will still want more, they will work. But B, precisely because in this way unemployed and so on will be demobilized in the sense of against wild political mobilization, you know, that this is even easier in a way than all this complicated mechanism of welfare support, whatever. It's something like a leftist counter proposal to flat tax or whatever, you know. And the calculation works, and there is also one nice motive, you know. The big Marxist argument against market, which is obviously true, is that although you and the capitalist are formally equal, like both of us can say to the other, fuck you, I don't like your proposal, how much wage, whatever, but you make a free choice. But how should I put it, for you as individual worker, the choice is much less free because your alternative, if you don't accept some offer, is you drop dead, you are hungry. But in this way, that's a nice point that I like, because it takes over the ideological right-wing motive that I mentioned. They say this is the true freedom of choice. With basic income, also for the workers, the taking a job or not will be a true freedom to choose, because you are not forced. It's not just a formal freedom, where of course you have to work. You really have a chance to say no, under these conditions, I prefer to leave. But why am I... What I find so ironic in this product is two things. First, that it is celebrated by the Negri gang. I don't mean this in a dismissive way. But why? Because if there is a motto of Negri gang, it's empire no longer state. The state is passé. But sorry, did I hear it correctly? The basic idea of basic income is that state gives to all citizens. So where is all that poetry about fluidity, no borders, and so on? State and citizenship, which is supposed, you know, we are all here the mantra, oh, don't think, no, you shouldn't any longer think in the terms of nation state and so on. They return with a vengeance. The second thing, what happens with the old Marxist idea of exploitation? If you cling to it, then you find, I love this, which is, for me, incidentally, what I will say now, a critical point against Marx, if anything, of how we should rethink the notion of exploitation of Marxist economics. Namely, what they basically proposed is that those few workers who really work should be exploited not only by the capitalist, but also by the unemployed, you know, like, a couple of us work and we are screwed from behind, from below, from above. That we working class find ourselves, if I may put plastic terms so that you will understand, in a sandwich position. You know, this sandwich movement between two men, you know. Should I have more plastic? Okay. No limits. This is no limits for taste. Okay, sorry, let me go on. So here I think, no, really to conclude, here I have problems with this Bayouth idea, which is, to put it, I don't have time to go through it, but to put it very brutally, subtraction, I'm sad that his new book is not yet translated. His introduction, how is it called? No, Manifest for Philosophy, Volume 2, where he develops his notion, which is the following one. Today, history with capital H no longer exists. Which means, he puts it in quite clear terms, that we no longer can claim to have a global social theory of the united, unique, all-encompassing world historical process. At that point, but you sound strangely, Baudrillard, postmodern. He says, we just have fragmented narratives. And his idea is explicitly, all we can do then is react intervene locally. All politics today is local. You see an injustice here, racism, you intervene. You see there, you intervene. As but you put it already years ago, for him, anti-capitalism doesn't have any meaning. You cannot, capitalism is everywhere. He says somewhere, it's the air we breathe. You cannot oppose it, it's meaningless. What can you oppose? You can oppose in politics, it's this or that, social, and so on and so on. And from here, he draws, for me, I'm so sad that I don't have time, a terrible conclusion for me. Nonetheless, he has to admit that, again, for him, historical reality is experienced, he openly puts it as symbolic fiction. You know what I will do, so that I'm not telling you bullshit now. Allow me to go on for 5 minutes and then for your Lacan.com. You told me before that you wanted 2 hours ago. I will, this final text of dialogue with Badiou, I will give it to you. If you don't send it to Badiou, okay? No, you know what I mean, because I'm now giving you in a tiny, shortened version. I want you to have a chance to, more seriously, with long passive, because that But Badiou's notion is the following one. This is what horrifies me. All of a sudden, he became even more Kantian than I thought. He started to advocate the notion of necessary illusion, fiction, a very Kantian notion. He claims that, and I'm not simplifying him, again, there is no history with capital H. No, we just have partial narratives and so on. And the only, these are symbolic fictions, the only real is the real of a political act. But, he says, it's not enough to mobilize us ideologically. You need a symbolic envelope, again, a story, to provide the illusory background to make meaningful the real of political engagement. Like, I see, to be very primitive, I see there suffering, women are beaten, other races, whatever you want. But it doesn't only work if you say, oh, suffering this. You need a story to embed in it. And he claims, this is how he even, and he claims that, this here he is very precise, when he talks about the idea of communism, this is, for him, this kind of necessary illusion. The idea is you have to provide a story for the real of the political engagement. I found this solution very tragic in a way. I reject it totally. Because he even goes here, I'm more sympathetic to him. People didn't get it what he was talking at the Communist Conference in London. He even, along the same lines, openly advocated that he is closer to me, the cult of personality. He claims you need a leader, like Stalin, whatever, Lenin, that precisely because of this necessary illusion. It cannot be just that, as he put it in a poetic way, look, I will give you a quote. If an idea is, it's here, I think, yes. If an idea is for an individual, the subjective operation by means of which a particular real truth is in an imaginary way projected into the symbolic movement of a history, then we can say that an idea presents the truth as if it is a fact, or that the idea presents certain facts as symbols of the real of the truth. It has to be that in the imaginary mode, the symbol comes to support the creative flight of the real. You got it. Real, evanescent, disappearing, you need to locate it in some narrative. But again, I don't buy this. It's too close to Lyotard for me. The idea is you have the real of an ethical commitment, but you need an illusion for it to work. You have to tell a story, a mythical story, and so on. What I don't buy is the underlying presupposition that, to cut a long story short, I put it like this way. Some of you know Marxism a little bit, and you know that the big struggle between dogmatic Marxists and Stalinists was that dogmatic Marxists had dialectical materialism and historical materialism. And the big point of Western Marxists was to reject dialectical materialism, as the Stalinist stupidity and who claimed historical materialism is all there is. But you almost does the opposite. He wants dialectical materialism without historical materialism. For him, historical materialism as the global theory of history is this bad Hegelianism. As if you can tell the total story of history, and this for him is communist ideology, maybe necessary but an illusion. Instead of communism being this punctual interventions on behalf of what he calls axiom of unconditional axiom of equality, like people are screwed there in a racist way, sexist, I intervene. But you need a story when you say this is the movement of history towards progress and so on and so on. I claim, with regard to what I developed before, that is to say, this new stage of capitalism where ideology, cultural ideology and politics are intertwined, intermixed. If we don't confront that, we are lost. We need more than ever a theory of, okay, maybe not history with capital H, not a narrative theory, but simply, I'm here very old-fashioned, a theory of what goes on today. Where are we today? What is happening? I mean, we don't know. Interestingly enough, the big opponents, liberal capitalists and old Marxists, agree that it's still capitalism. This is the only guys who agree. But it's an open question. I think it is, but one must qualify this very much. What is happening now in China? And so, okay, I know now that in China, even Mao is made a capitalist. Did you read in the last issue of Time magazine, I think, I checked through email, a wonderful news, that big director, you know, Jiang, Fatih, whatever, who did The Hero and so on, he now totally sold to the establishment, no? And he made a mega spectacle, mega movie, telling the story, Mao founding 49 People's Republic in China, and I really had to laugh the way it is described, and I believe it, that it's in the best Stalinist way, although in pro-capitalist terms, the history is rewritten to justify Deng Xiaoping and today's China. For example, I love this. You have a scene where just before taking Beijing in 49, communist groups liberate a small city just outside Beijing, and Mao walks along the street and looks for a shop where he could find some brand of cigarettes that he was smoking to buy. And then they inform him that all the rich people, bourgeoisie, have escaped the communists, no? And then Mao said, sooner or later we will have to bring capitalists back and so on. Well, like Mao already knew. And I love this guy, you know. But okay, what I'm saying is that for our here, I don't, no, I'm more serious, I don't buy this Badiou's abstract ethics of the purity of the idea. I don't want to take too much time to quote him now, but he goes so far as to directly oppose the Mao's slogan, dare to win. You know, this is the great, don't be afraid to win. And basically he says that, he turns it around. He says that the lesson of today, 21st century, is that to win means to lose in an even more radical way. He claims there are three ways to lose. The first way is a direct defeat. You are simply crushed by the enemy. The second way is to lose in the victory itself. You win, but you become a new power structure, like Stalinism or social democracy. You start to imitate the enemy. And the next one is the radical one, Sendero Luminoso, Kampuchea, Pol Pot, China Cultural Revolution. You want to remain pure, but you end up in self-destructive violence. He calls this very nicely, poetically, almost sacrificial temptation of the void. And his result is all these catastrophes happen, the three defeats, because you dared to win. You want to take, you did risk to take power. His idea is no, we should subtraction, withdraw, and so on and so on. I have problems here. I think that, like, we really need to confront what is today's capitalism. And unfortunately, I don't think it is already done. And I'm not kidding, this is not just as a sign of flattering gratitude to you. You play a crucial role here. By you, I mean art galleries, precisely because we live in an epoch of cultural capitalism. You are, as Fred James so nicely analyzed, you are no longer just a the term cultural capitalism means many things. Among other things, means that you no longer have, you know, basis where you produce real thing and superstructure. Cultural production is part of the base today. The battles have to be fought here, not to play this game of subtraction or whatever, resistance and so on and so on. I don't know. Now don't ask me how to do it. The only thing I know is that if we will not do it, we will in 50 years live in a society in which maybe I would prefer not to live. You know that I almost, you know, I know from my youth a wonderful joke, among others, that the tasteless joke, but this one is not tasteless. From Soviet Union, the idea is that people gather on the 1st of May, and then there is a big poster. In 10 years, our society will reach communism, no? And then a guy starts to laugh and jump out of joy. And they ask him, what, are you crazy? He said, ha ha, I have cancer, I will not be alive. Like, without doing something, I have almost the same reaction. I'm sorry if I was too long, but what could you do? You were forced to listen. It's like change as far as possible. They like changes in Venezuela, in Cuba, you know, you can sympathize, but they are there, they don't disturb your market for paintings you will sell, your department power struggles and so on. Revolutions are nice when they are there, you know. And then you say, my God, I live in this corrupted society, you know, how much more would I like to be there? Fuck you, go there. I like even my right-wing motto, which is true. I love it. I always like this truth in Peter. You know this old leftist motto, protesting neo-colonialism, Yankee go home. You know which is now the new version? Yankee go home, but take me with you, please. No. There are moments of truth in this. And again, if left really wants to do something, we have to start asking hard questions. It is 2 hours, why don't we stop? I don't like democracy. I don't like democracy.
It's enough.
Yeah, I don't like democracy. I don't like to pretend. So what I'm saying is that they did make one point, and of course here is where our attack should admit, so that now you will see that I'm not a total liberal idiot or whatever. I am opposed to this. You know where the description is obviously false? When Zerapolio describes, opposes in such a stupid way, bureaucracy and market. Wait a minute. Today's postmodern capitalism, precisely in its flexibility and dynamics, needs more than ever state mediation and state regulation. I mean, are we aware that, look at all, but as a counter example, don't forget that it was Bush, not the Democratic president, who tried to, who did the first legalization, you know, that rule, if you are 2 years here, you get the green card or whatever. Because to put it in the most primitive terms of class analysis, it is in the interest of the ruling class to to liberalize immigration, or to put it in a different way. You know, some leftists usually talk as if anti-immigrant racism is some kind of imperialist plot out there, that you will remain a marginal, rejected by majority, and so on. Let me make it very clear. If this were to become a state politics, let's just open borders. You would have in 1 month, not the imperialist revolution, but the frustrated working class revolution. Beware what happened in the United States. Do you remember that? There are also moments of beautiful solidarity. I remember how, I think in Seattle, something beautiful happened. Immigrant Spaniards and your own trade unions demonstrated together. This was a beautiful thing. The situation described by Zaera Polio, there is a moment of truth in it, my God. Capitalism has this, has reinvented itself after 68 with this really terrifying, efficient, let's call it bombastically postmodern, whatever, dynamics. And sorry to tell you, I don't see any serious, what they call it, immediate, at least, alternative of the left. I respect them. The left is the moderate left, all the Econ Stiglitz, Krugman,